Donald George Bradman, the sportsman who has become a legend in his lifetime. He was perhaps the greatest run-making machine that cricket has ever known. If Bradman was going to bat, the ground was full to capacity. And the spectators, hundreds of thousands of them down through the years, were never disappointed. For he was the Don. His batting was power rather than poetry, but it had the magic touch. He gripped the bat in a way no man gripped it before him or since. But then there's only been one Don Bradman. As agile as a ballet dancer, and despite his smallish stature, powerful enough to hit sixes in the world's biggest grounds. It was against India that he made his 100th hundred, easily the best achievement by an Australian in first-class matches. He made 37 double centuries too. Australian cricket has produced many champions. Charles Bannerman, the first top-class Australian batsman. Warren Bardsley, the first man to make a century in each innings of a test. Victor Trumper, another legendary figure, equally at home on good wickets or bad, and said by all who saw his mastery to be one of the greatest cricketers the world has ever seen. These were the Don's cricketing ancestors, and he eclipsed them all. It is almost 20 years since his last test. Now he's Sir Donald Bradman, businessman. For cricket lovers, young and old, here is the Don in memoirs. Australian cricket began in 1868 when an Aborigine team visited England. They were led by Mullock, a star bowler, batsman and wicketkeeper. The official wicketkeeper was Bullocky, and among the others were Mosquito, Red Crow, King Cole and Twopenny. Cricket had arrived in Australia. This was Sydney Cricket Ground 80 years ago. And cricket wasn't only a game, it was a social occasion. Cricket produced great Australians, men like M.A. Noble and the South Australian left-hander Clem Hill. The first Australian 11 went to England in 1878, and there were only 11 men. The captain was D.W. Gregory, 32 years of age. There were brothers in the team too, Charles Bannerman, who was born in Kent, and his brother Alec. Warwick Armstrong was an Australian captain many years later, but no one in cricket's hierarchy had yet heard of a baby who had been christened Donald George Bradman. He was born in Cootamundra in New South Wales, but as a child his parents moved to Bowral in the Southern Highlands. Bowral is quiet, rather like an English village. It didn't know then that it was to become famous as the residence of the boy from Bowral. At 12, Don Bradman was already a cricketer, a good one. The local oval was just across the street from the house in which he lived, and he developed a love for cricket, a passion for a great game. He practiced by hitting a golf ball with a stump, and many say this is what gave him the fantastic eye which stood him in such stead later in his career. He practiced whenever he could. Like all boys, he went to school, but he was different. He attended to his studies, but was outstanding at cricket. He made 50s, 100s, 200s, 300s. At 16, he was a local hero on the cricket field. At 18, he was summoned to Sydney for trials to play for New South Wales. One of its stalwarts was Bert Oldfield, a great wicketkeeper who had played for the AIF team and was reckoned the best in the world. Bert Oldfield, a man who remembers many tests, also remembers Bradman's debut.
Don came down from Bowral in 1926 to the Sydney Cricket Ground in the practice nets. But the following year, he played in the New South Wales state side when we went to Adelaide and Melbourne. He scored a century in his first appearance at Adelaide. It was a remarkable performance. In fact, his entry into first-class cricket was romantic. When he came down from Barrel, he impressed everybody by his superb confidence. And the selectors were equally impressed because they picked him within 12 months to go down to Adelaide and Melbourne. And what do you think, in 12 months' time, he had the distinction and the honour of playing as a youngster, 18, a mere youth, in the first Test match for Australia at Brisbane in November 1928. And who do you think was playing in that Test match? Harold Larwood, not Bodyline, and Morris Tate, the genius of the medium pace bowlers. It was a remarkable performance on the part of Don Bradman, who only getting 18 in the first innings. I sat with him at the Brisbane match, and he said to me, wickets were falling LBW. He said, he won't get me that way. But he did. Morris Tate got him. LBW.
Young Bradman was not only a cricketer, he was a pianist, and as a golfer, he would make many professionals ashamed. You name the sport, from ping pong to wrestling, and Bradman was its master. And yet, cricket was his first love, and cricket gave him his greatest rewards and greatest satisfaction.
It was in 1930 that Don Bradman went to England with the Australian Test team under Billy Woodfull. And what a wonderful team it was. Nearly all youngsters. There was Archie Jackson and Stan McCabe and Alan Fairfax and many others. But by the brilliant leadership of Billy Woodfull, he brought Don Bradman almost out because of his natural talents. On he went in the Test matches. We didn't score very many runs in the first Test, but at Leeds, he staggered the world and staggered the opponents, the bowlers, in making 334 for the first time he ever appeared at Leeds. And what a wonderful performance it was. It didn't bring success to Australia. We didn't win, but we brought fame through Don's brilliance.
That year, Bradman received a gift of £1,000 from an admirer. Billy Woodfull was Australia's captain, and Bradman met King George V for the first time. Later, of course, he was to be knighted by George VI. This was Bradman's first English tour, a triumph for him and for Australia. The final Test was at Lord's, and here Australia won by 7 wickets.
Geo Allen facing Grimmett, wanting one for his 50. Percy Chapman is facing Hornibrook, wanting 4 for his century. Percy Chapman just cut wall through the slips. It looks like a boundary. It is.
Triumphant Australians returned home, and the most triumphant of them, Donald George Bradman, was met by his parents. The two big B's of Australian cricket, Bradman and Bannerman, and Bradman with A.G. Moyes, one of the selectors who brought him from Bowral. Bradman was on top of the wave. He was the idol of the crowds, a scourge of bowlers. But in England, a plot was being hatched to keep him quiet, a plot which came to be known as Bodyline. The 1932 English side was captained by Douglas Jardine. It included wicketkeeper Duckworth and fast bowler Harold Larwood. And it was on Larwood, though the Australians didn't know it, that Bodyline depended. But the Australians soon learned about Bodyline. Stan McCabe and Jack Fingleton both wore heavy padding when they faced the English bowlers in the Tests of 1932. Stan McCabe became a hero with an innings of 187 not out. But it was Bradman that Bodyline was after. Bodyline was a combination of bowling at the batsman and a close field. Bill Ponsford was one of its victims. England somehow had to cut down Bradman's scoring. Larwood was the spearhead. It's tense. Larwood to Bradman. Bradman scored only 1 century in this series, and when Walter Hammond hit the winning 6 to conclude it, everyone was happy. D. Douglas Jardine had curbed Bradman's scoring, but he had nearly killed cricket in the process.
2 years later, in 1934, Don again went back to England, also under the captaincy of Bill Woodfull, the psychologist. And it was a magnificent success, the same as 1930. Bradman, again at Leeds, in a test match, made 304, which was a world's record, equaling his own record, and which is still a world's record in test cricket today.
On this tour, Bradman was met by the mayor of Southampton, scored 8 more centuries, had to be assisted from the field at Headingley with a pulled muscle, and decided when he returned to Australia to move to Adelaide. He packed his car and Sydney said goodbye. And because he wasn't playing, the Sydney cricket ground was suddenly empty. In 36, another English team arrived with some new faces. There was Farns, fast bowler. C.J. Barnett, batsman. Hedley Verity, spin bowler. And of course, that great batsman, Walter Hammond. It was to be a tremendous season. England won the first 2 tests, Australia the last 3 to take the Ashes. Donald Bradman was Australia's captain, and here is the 4th test played in Adelaide.
This romantic cricketer from Barrel, Don Bradman, he continued his success when 8 years later he was chosen Australia's captain of our test team against England, also at Brisbane in 1936. Although we didn't have a terrific amount of success in that match, we were caught on a sticky wicket and we were out for 50-odd in the second innings. The match holds a great amount of sentiment and interest for me, because it was there that I beat the world's wicket-keeping record, which Dick Lilly had held from England for 30 years. It was then that I stumped Hardstaff off Ward, and that brought me the record of 90 wickets in a test matches against England, and it still is a world's record, and that was linked itself with Don Bradman's first entry as captain in this test team.
1938, back from England. Fleetwood Smith was in the team. So were Barnes and Badcock, Stan McCabe, Chipperfield, Bill O'Reilly, Billy Brown. But war clouds were gathering. The following year, Australia was at war. Bradman joined the Air Force, then transferred to the Army. But soon he was discharged, medically unfit. He played cricket occasionally to raise funds for wartime charities. At the end of the war, Bradman's health was bad. He decided he owed a debt to cricket and would try to make a comeback. And when the Englishmen went out to field, they didn't know whether Bradman would still be the terror he was pre-war. They soon found out. Captain, Bradman all seemed destined to lose the toss, which suited Wally Hammond fine. The Australians took the field. And record holder Len Hutton and Cyril Washbrook opened for England. That's tribe to Washbrook. McCool to Compton. And just watch this catch. Here it is again in slow motion. This was the second test of the series, and England did not fare well. But the stands were full when it was Australia's turn to bat. Barnes and Morris opened, and Morris was first to go. Then came Bradner. Bradman and Barnes each scored 234, a record partnership. Sid Barnes remembers.
That's a long time back, but I remember Don and I still, I think we still hold the world's record for a fifth wicket partnership. He got 234 and I got 234. I had two trips with Don, 38 and 48, and I would say he'd be possibly the greatest cricketer that I have played with and have seen. He, I would link with Stan McCabe, Don and Bill O'Reilly as the three greatest cricketers I've known. He was a wonderful help to me and a wonderful sportsman, wonderful ambassador for the country. And as I repeated before, whatever he was likely to take on, he would be a great man at.
It was Australia's test, and Bradman's last on the Sydney cricket ground. In Melbourne, Australia batted first, and then it was England's turn. Here's McCool bowling to Compton. Freer to Godfrey-Evans. And a chase for Bradman. Prime Minister Menzies watched the match with Dennis Compton. McCool again, and England are all out. Bradman made 79 in the first innings, and Arthur Morris made a century in the second. The crowd wanted to see Bradman again. It was to be his last innings here. Yardley bowling. A tense match, but there were lighter moments, such as when the drunk strolled onto the field. This fellow must have had a very sore head the next day. Certainly is crowded here today. The Duke and Duchess of Gloucester saw the match and the teams were introduced. Then back to cricket, and Bradman, the fieldsman, strikes a blow for Australia. Lindsay Hassett takes a catch too. And then came the rain. Arthur Morris was there. What do you think of Bradman, Arthur?
Well, the first test I played was in 1946, and he captained the sides from 1946 to the 1948 tour of England, and then he retired. But I didn't see him before the war, Bill, but they told me he was a tremendous player. For instance, the bowler would come down and bowl the ball, and he'd promptly hit it where the fieldsman had been shifted from, or something like that, you know. He was one of those devilish people. But really a great player before the war, and a very fine player after the war.
1946, and Bradman's last test series in Australia was over. But there was one series to come. England, 1948. To Windsor, where he strolled in the grounds with the royal family. Lords, the headquarters of cricket, and Bradman's last appearance. Barnes and Morris opened for Australia, and great batsmen though they were, the crowd only wanted to see Bradman. Morris made 105. The Duchess of Gloucester sees Australia make 350 and then 460 for seven. The Duke of Edinburgh was there too to see Bradman's second innings, 89. Hassett was out. Miller made 74, and when Australia declared, England needed 596 runs. It was Australia's test. The crowd cheered Bradman, and at the Savoy Hotel, he was given an official farewell.
And I think I'm probably the best judge of the many little creaks and groans that go on in my joints throughout the day, especially when we're out in the field. And I'm quite sure I shall have no regrets at all in having to sit in the pavilion and watch the other fellows.
It was Auld Lang Syne. Farewell to England and to Test cricket. Farewell to the stage on which he'd been the star for 20 years. Back home, back to his family, to John and Shirley and his wife. In 1963, he made a brief reappearance in Canberra. In the national capital, he is still remembered. And not only in the national capital.
Well, Bill, abilities don't change, and the technique improves, but of course, Don Bradman's a genius. He was the greatest of all batsmen. I didn't see Trumper, but as far as I'm concerned, in my day, he was brilliant.
Yes, Don not only was a great ambassador for the country and the game, he was a wonderful tactician. Many a time he would think these players out that were really embedded in. We could never budge them. But Don would always come up with something, and I'd say that he had more brains than when he played than most of the English skippers and our own Australian players. That he was a wonderful man to tour with. He could always build you up to great heights. And I would say he'd be the greatest player that I have played with and against.
Sir Donald Bradford, the Don, the boy from Bowral, the man who rewrote the record books, the greatest cricketer of them all.